Acts, the research, part 3. We've been looking at the book Undeniable by Douglas Acts, subtitled How Biology Confirms Our Intuition That Life is Designed, published this year by HarperCollins. And the question that we raised at the end of going through the book is, where does Acts get the confidence to say that we should believe our design intuition and ignore what is the current scientific consensus? And there were three sets of papers. One set culminated in Douglas Axe's paper in 2000, Extreme Functional Sensitivity to Conservative Amino Acid Changes on Enzyme Exteriors. And notice that that's published in the Journal of Molecular Biology. It's still out there in the peer-reviewed literature, and I haven't seen anybody adequately critique it, or even try, frankly. Maybe there's some trying somewhere, but it certainly hasn't grabbed headlines. And then the second week, we looked at Douglas Axe's paper of 2004, estimating the prevalence of protein sequences adopting functional enzyme folds, again, in the Journal of Molecular Biology. And again, I have not seen a critique of that after looking at multiple citations. That one was actually not written from Oxford, and he had to move out of Oxford after the first paper. But it was still in a research campus. This next set comes after he had moved completely out of Oxford entirely and now was working in the Discovery Institute's laboratory and published in a journal friendly to intelligent design, which of course means that it doesn't really count in the literature. As a matter of fact, I did not find any citations on this paper whatsoever, except for intelligent design advocates. I don't even think I saw anybody for an intelligent design critic that cited it. And I think the reason why is because there isn't a really good answer, but if they publish an attempted answer that's shot down, then that's in the peer-reviewed literature and it draws attention to the subject. It's actually paired with another paper, this time published by Gager and Axe in 2011, where they studied the evolutionary accessibility of new enzyme functions, a case study from the biotin pathway, and we'll be going over both of those papers together today. Little background for the first paper we're going to be reviewing. Michael Behe published The Edge of Evolution in 2007. And Dirt and Schmidt said, oh no, they've got it wrong. It isn't hundreds of millions of years it would take. It isn't billions of years that it would take. It's only hundreds of millions of years that it would take to get two amino acid change, two base change from a human ancestor, presumably half monkey or whatever, to a human. Which, of course, since there's only supposed to be 6 million years of time, means that all of the changes have to be done single mutations at a time, which is, you know, if you think about all of the changes that have made and all of the changes that need to be made to get from an ape-like creature of some kind to a human that thinks and talks and does all the things humans do, or even, you know, 3/4 of the things humans do. There isn't enough time, and they've really shot themselves in the foot. And that's why they don't answer, is because of this problem. I talked about that, the mistake in making a strategy of trying to answer intelligent design from a strategic point in the video, Don't Mess With ID, which is available on the internet. If you want to, you can just Google it. This particular line also starts out with Michael Lynch and one of his graduate students by the name of Abegg, the rate of establishment of complex adaptations. Again, this is available on the internet. You don't have to take my word for it. You can actually read that. And those of you who are getting the email, there's a link to those, so you don't even have to take notes or look it up on video later. You can just click the link. The abstract of that paper starts out, a central problem in evolutionary theory concerns the mechanisms by which adaptations requiring multiple mutations emerge in natural populations. Notice that this is still a problem after how many years now? We developed a series of expressions that clarify the scaling of the time to establishment of complex adaptations with population size, mutation rate, magnitude of the selective disadvantage of the intermediate stage alleles. How bad is it that how disadvantageous is it that you have a mutation? And the complexity of the adaptation. How many changes do you actually have to make to get from one protein to another? In general, even in the face of deleterious intermediate steps, the time to establishment is minimized by populations with very large size. Well, surprise. Under a broad range of conditions, the time to establishment also scales by no more than the square of the mutation rate. Now, that's a little more surprising, regardless of the number of sites contributing to the adaptive change. 7, 10, 20, however many amino acids you want to go, all that really matters is how fast are they mutating. Now, that's kind of an unbelievable statement, but demonstrating that the emergence of complex adaptations is only weakly constrained by the independent acquisition of mutations at the underlying sites. If you want 1, it's hard. If you want 2, it's a little harder, but not much. If you want 4, it's a little harder, 8, 20, however many. All that really matters is the mutation rate. Mutator alleles with deleterious side effects have only moderate effects on the rate of adaptation in large populations, but can cause a quantum decrease in the time to establishment of some adaptive alleles in small populations. If you have a small population needing to get lots of mutators, or having some that are deleterious are a big problem. Large populations, no. Although probably not at a high enough rate to offset the increased deleterious mutation load. Now, if you're looking at that and you're going, what in the world is the deleterious mutation load? Well, what they're talking about is genetic entropy. They're talking about if you can fix one deleterious mutation, then maybe you can fix other deleterious mutations, and as time goes on, the organism gradually degrades, which is presumably why California condors are having so much trouble right now, since there are only about 17 of them at one point. Transient hypermutability, whereby a subset of gamete-producing cells mutate at an elevated rate in a non-heritable manner. Oh, they all just got mutated at extra. I don't know. They ate some mutagenic stuff, or maybe there was extra cosmic rays coming through. May also elevate the rate of adaptation, although the effect is modest and appears to be result from a simple increase in the rate of transitions between intermediate states rather than from the saltational production of doublet mutations. How about the saltational product of 5, 6, 10 mutations at once? most people would acknowledge that that's way outside the reach of any kind of reasonable mutation evolutionary scenario, as we'll see later. Taken together, these results illustrate the plausibility of the relatively rapid emergence of specific complex adaptations by conventional population genetic mechanisms. If you can get all those things done fast, why, you just standard genetic mechanisms will account for it, and provide insight into the relative incidences of various paths of allelic adaptation in organisms with different population genetic features. Now, I'm going to quote a few pages or paragraphs from Lynch and Abegg. Understanding the mechanistic origins of complex adaptations, this is actually the first paragraph, here defined as character alterations requiring more than one novel mutation to yield a functional advantage. So complex is more than one. Two is complex. Remains a central challenge for evolutionary biology. Hartle and Tobbs, Orr, DiPristo et al., Dean and Thornton. Whoa. After all this time, they're still having to work on this. They really don't have an idea. Some have even questioned whether conventional mutational mechanisms and current principles of population genetics are capable of explaining the emergence of complex adaptations on reasonable evolutionary timescales. For example, Behe and Snoke, Pigliucci. Now, Pigliucci is, as far as I know, an atheist. And he's saying it can't happen with the current mechanisms we have. Behe and Snoke, of course, are intelligent design advocates who are saying it can't happen. And look at all those other people that say it's really hard to have happen. And you realize that this is a problem they haven't solved and may not be solvable. Now, of course, Lynch and Abegg are going to say, oh no, we can solve it. Because mutations are rare events, the origin of complex adaptations is often expected to occur at very low rates in small populations owing to the long cumulative time span necessary for the independent arrival and sequential fixation of multiple mutations. In contrast, whereas large populations provide more individual targets for mutational origin, should the intermediate steps toward a complex adaptation be disadvantageous, the increased efficiency of selection against intermediate mutants in large populations might inhibit adaptational advance. If you have a very small population, it's going to happen where you going the way you want it to at very low rates, and furthermore, these are the ones that are subject to genetic entropy and are likely to be lost. On the other hand, if you have a large population, then the intermediate steps are selected against, and so they don't occur, or at least they occur at very low levels. So it doesn't matter how you figure it, it's not going to work well. I'm going to skip down a ways. That's my ellipses, although fixed mutator alleles theoretically have an especially high likelihood of spawning adaptive alleles in small populations. One could argue that the latter situation is unlikely to be biologically sustainable, as any population that is capable of fixing alleles with mildly deleterious effects will typically be on a path to extinction. That's our genetic entropy showing up again. Now, noting that realistic population sizes, mutation rates, and selective coefficients have been applied throughout, these results that quite complex alleles with multiple neutral or deleterious intermediate steps can readily emerge in populations on time scales of 10 to the... That must be 10 to the 10th generations. I'm not sure how that got the way it did. Thus, for microbes with generation lengths of hours to days and very large population sizes, the mean time to establishment can easily be on the order of a few weeks to several months, depending on the complexity of the final allelic state. Now, I want you to notice what he's saying here is that you keep bacteria around for a few weeks to several months, certainly less than a year. They can evolve pretty much anything they want to. Now, if you're going at this point, wait a minute, that's not what I've seen in the laboratory. Well, you're correct. Something is wrong here. Even multicellular species with effective population sizes in the vicinity of 10, and there must be 10 to the something, and it's 10 to the fifth, I believe. Unfortunately, this hid from me when I was correcting it, are capable of establishing fairly complex adaptations on timescales of a few tens of millions of generations. The exact time span, depending on the magnitude of selective disadvantages, advantages or disadvantages of the intermediate and end states. So, now, of course, we're multicellular species. And according to standard theory, we've had, you know what, I'm going to fix that. Escape. No, that's not what I wanted to do. There. We will. Okay, it's 10 to the 6th. So, there we are. Now, I know for sure. Okay, so that's saying infected population sizes in the vicinity of a million. Actually, it is felt that humans have been around supposedly with about 10 to the 5th to 10 to the 4th, probably 10 to the 5th individuals for millions of years. So, this is bigger than humans, and look at this, of a few tens of millions of generations. Let's say that generation time for humans was 10 years, which is really pushing it. Okay. Let's say that would be a few hundreds of millions of years. In other words, it isn't going to happen in the supposed 6 million years that you're supposed to have had. What they're saying is right up front that human, elephant, whale, evolution just can't happen the way that it's been portrayed. Interesting that they don't, it's like they don't even realize what they're saying right there. Skipping on. Now we come to Axe's reply, and I'm going to read his abstract. To explain life's current level of complexity, we must first explain genetic innovation. Recognition of this fact has generated interest in the evolutionary feasibility of complex adaptations. Adaptations requiring multiple mutations, with all intermediates being non-adaptive. Intuitively, one expects the waiting time for arrival and fixation of these adaptations to have exponential dependence on D, that is, the number of specific base changes they require. Counter to this expectation, Lynch and Abegg, that's the paper we were just looking at, have recently concluded that in this case of selectively neutral intermediates, the waiting time becomes independent of D as D becomes large. Here I confirm the intuitive expectation by showing where the analysis of Lynch and Abegg erred and by developing new treatments of the two cases of complex adaptation. The case where intermediates are selectively maladaptive and the case where they are selectively neutral. In particular, I use an explicit model of a structured bacterial population similar to the island model of Maruyama and Kimura to examine the limits on complex adaptations during the evolution of paralogous genes, genes related by duplication of an ancestral gene. That is to say, gene A makes two copies of itself, and then one copy has to stay working because it's doing what A was supposed to do, and the other copy is now free to mutate and gradually mutates into gene B. Although substantial functional innovations is thought to be possible within paralogous families, the tight limits on the value of D found here, D is equal to or less than 2 for the maladaptive case, and D is equal to or less than 6 for the neutral case. And it will depend on where, obviously, if D is very, very slightly maladaptive, it'll be like 3 or 4 or 5. Mean that the mutational jumps in this process cannot have been very large. Whether the functional divergence commonly attributed to paralogs is feasible within such tight limits is far from certain, and our next paper will address that. Judging by various experimental attempts to interconvert the functions of supposed paralogs, this study provides a mathematical framework for interpreting experiments of that kind, more of which will be needed before the limits to functional divergence become clear. Well, at least we know what we're looking at. And skipping on down, three potential routes to the fixation of complex adaptations have been recognized. The simplest is the de novo appearance in one organism of all the necessary changes, which for large innovations is tantamount to a molecular saltation. One day, animal had protein A, and the next day, its descendant had protein A plus protein B. That doesn't make a lot of sense. This route has the advantage, well, unless you're designing it, of course, this route has the advantage of avoiding non-adaptive intermediates, but the disadvantage of requiring a very rare convergence of mutations. The second potential route is sequential fixation, whereby point mutations become fixed successively, ultimately producing the full set needed for the innovation. Mutation 1, mutation 2, mutation 3, mutation 4, mutation 5, and finally mutation 6, and now you have your new enzyme B. By this route, the rate of appearance of each successive intermediate en route to the complex adaptation is boosted by allowing the prior intermediates to become fixed. But because these fixation events have to occur without the assistance of natural selection, or, in the case of maladaptive intermediates, even against natural selection, they are in themselves improbable events. The third potential route is stochastic tunneling, which differs from sequential fixation only in that it depends on each successive point mutation appearing without the prior one having become fixed. So if you have two mutations, well, you have one organism that makes one mutation, has several descendants, but doesn't take over the whole population. And then the second one of those descendants flips over to mutation 2, which now has a competitive advantage and does take over the population. That's called stochastic tunneling. Here, fixation occurs only after all the mutations needed for the innovation are in place. This route therefore benefits from an absence of improbable fixation events, but it must instead rely on the necessary mutations appearing within much smaller subpopulations. Molecular saltation seems incompatible with Darwinian evolution. That's kind of obvious. Because of this, sequential fixation and stochastic tunneling are thought to be the primary ways that complex adaptations become fixed. However, in view of the fact that the underlying limitation is an unavoidable aspect of statistics, that independent rare events only very rarely occur in combination, it seems certain that all chance-based mechanisms must encounter it. whether they be saltational or, whether they be stochastic or whether they be sequential fixation. Among the many treatments of complex adaptations by sequential fixation and or stochastic tunneling, for example, references 2 to 6, 6 happens to be Lynch and Abegg, as we saw. One recently offered by Lynch and Abegg is of particular interest because it claims that the above limitation vanishes in situations where the genetic intermediates en route to a complex adaptation are selectively neutral. For this case, they report that, quote, regardless of the complexity of the adaptation, the time to establishment is inversely proportional to the rate at which mutations arise at single sites. In other words, they find the waiting time for appearance and fixation for a complex adaptation requiring D base changes to scale as U minus 1 rather than the commonly assumed U minus D. Because this should apply not only in the case of strict neutrality, which may seldom exist, but also in the more realistic case of approximate neutrality, a little bit disadvantageous, but not much. And because it represents a striking departure from common probabilistic intuitions, it is important for this result to be examined carefully. Indeed, a simple thought experiment seems to justify skepticism with respect to it. The number of ways to specify D bases changes in a gene that is L bases in length is this complicated formula, which has 3 to the D power, which is, if you're doing 30 base changes, you're talking 3 to the 30th, and then L taken D parts at a time, if L is like 200 and D is 30, this top thing has, 100 minus 30, which would be 70 times 71 times 72 times 73 times 74 times 75. As you can imagine, that gets to be a very, very large number rapidly, which can easily exceed the number of organisms that have existed on Earth. There are, for example, some 10 to the 72 ways to make 30 base changes of a gene of kilobase length. For any gene of a given gene of this size, then, we can be certain that the vast majority of variants that differ at 30 base positions have never existed. And since existence is a prerequisite for fixation, if it doesn't exist, you can't fix it in the population, we can be equally certain that the vast majority of these variants cannot have become fixed in any real population. Moreover, we do not have to make any assumptions about selective neutrality in order to draw this conclusion. It's true for selectively neutral, selectively disadvantageous, it doesn't matter. Skipping down a little further in the paper, they have an equation that's there from Lynch and Abegg's paper that they quote. And they go on to say, but if the implications of this equation are as implausible as has been argued, then there must be a mistake in the calculation. You know, it's a little bit like the people who prove that 2 equals 1, you know. Somewhere there's an error there. This indeed appears to be the case. Specifically, of all the possible evolutionary paths a population can take, the analysis of Lynch and Abegg considers only those special paths that lead directly to the desired end, the complex adaptation. This is best illustrated with an example. Suppose a population carries an allele, again, I missed taking that out, that confers no selective benefit in its current state. For example, a pseudogene or a gene duplicate, but which would confer a benefit if it were to acquire 5 specific nucleotide changes relative to that initial state, which we will again refer to as stage 0. Lynch and Abegg assign a waiting time of 5u to the minus 1 for a stage 1 allele to become fixed in this situation, which is valid only if we can safely assume that the population remains at stage 0 during this wait. But this cannot be assumed. A stage 0 allele of kilobase length, for example, would have about 200-fold more correct bases than incorrect ones with respect to the complex adaptation, which means that the rate of degradation, that is, fixation of changes that make the complex adaptation more remote, would be about 600-fold higher than the rate of progression to stage one. It is therefore very unlikely in such a case that the population will wait at stage zero long enough to reach stage one, and the situation becomes progressively worse as we consider higher stages. In other words, while you're mutating all the good mutations in, you've got all these bad mutations that are destroying the enzyme before it can ever be used in its final form. It is possible to adjust the problem to some extent in order to achieve a more favorable result. For example, if we suppose that all changes except the five desired ones are highly maladaptive, so that they like kill the organism, then fixation becomes restricted to changes at the five sites. But even under these artificial restrictions, equation 2 is incorrect in that it ignores back mutations. Productive changes cannot be banked. There isn't this ratchet. Oh, once you get there, you get to keep it. In fact, that's the whole point of neutral mutation, is that there isn't a ratchet. And of course, deleterious mutation is a ratchet going the other way. It's making it worse. Productive changes cannot be banked, whereas equation 2 presupposes that they can. So the estimate is wildly inaccurate. Stochastic tunneling. Lynch and Abegg's treatment of stochastic tunneling with neutral intermediates is also problematic. I'm going to skip over all the math on it. If you're interested, you can read the paper. This leads them to the unexpected conclusion that, quote, in very large populations with neutral intermediates, as D approaches infinity, the time to establishment converges on the reciprocal of the per site mutation rate, becoming independent of the number of mutations required for adaptation. Again, that's a nonsensical answer. But since they have in this way neglected the effect of D, it should be no surprise that they find D to have little effect. If you take it out of your original equations, it's not going to show at the end. Skipping down, because gene expression carries a metabolic cost, we expect duplicate genes to be maladaptive, unless their expression is substantially curtailed, because you're making this protein and it doesn't do anything, you're wasting resources. Consistent with this, a recent study has found that a wide variety of mutations that reduce expression of a non-functional gene are rapidly fixed during extended serial cultures. Perhaps you put a stop codon in, or you mutate the promoter region so that it no longer is made. And then, of course, when you get the final enzyme that you want, the stop codon is still there, or the mutation in the promoter region is still there. And kind of to sum it up, this is Doug Axe's model for neutral mutations. This is his model for two different varieties of deleterious mutations. And if you read the notes, you can tell, you know, how deleterious they are. And this is Lynch and Abegg's model, which you'll notice just flattens out. And it doesn't matter how many mutations you do, it doesn't go much beyond that line right there, which is about 10 to the 9th organisms at one time, which means that you should be able to get any mutation you want in a billion organisms, which is not hard to do if you're having a plate with bacteria on it. Well, his point is that 10 to the 13th or 10 to the 14th, it doesn't make too much difference, is about as many organisms as have been on the Earth at, anywhere for evolutionary time. And so you expect maybe two mutations if they're deleterious. You expect maybe six mutations if they're neutral. And that's all. So even in the most favorable case, where it doesn't really matter that the bacteria is churning out protein that doesn't do anything, which it should matter, that should be deleterious, that you're still looking at no more than six. Now, why is that important? It's because of our second paper by Giem and Axe. again, I'll read the abstract. Enzymes group naturally into families according to similarity of sequence, structure, and underlying mechanisms. Enzymes belonging to the same family are considered to be homologs, the product of evolutionary divergence, whereby the first family member provided a starting point for conversions to new but related functions. In fact, despite their similarities, these families can include remarkable functional diversity. Here we focus not on minor functional variations within families, but rather on innovations, transitions to genuinely new catalytic functions. Prior experimental attempts to reproduce such transitions have typically found that many mutational changes are needed to achieve even weak functional conversion, which raises the question of their evolutionary feasibility. If you're only allowed 6 and you need 20, or you need 7, or you need 12, it's not going to happen in reasonable time. And reasonable being billions of years. To further investigate this, we examined the members of a large enzyme superfamily, the PLP-dependent transferases, to find a pair with distinct reaction chemistries and high structural similarities. And in a bit, we'll see just how high the structural similarity is. We then set out to convert one of these enzymes to amino-3-ketobutyrate CoA ligase, which they abbreviate KBL2. You can imagine why they don't want to say the whole thing all the time. To perform the metabolic function of the other 8-amino-7-oxo-nonano-8 synthetase, BioF2. After identifying and testing 29 amino acid changes, we found 3 groups of active site positions and 1 single position where KBL2 side chains are incompatible with BioF2 function. So you have to make 7 changes in order to make this work, period, at least. Converting these side chains in KBL2 makes the residues in the active site cavity identical to those of BioF2, but nonetheless fails to produce detectable BioF2-like function in vivo. So even after we make these changes, it still doesn't work. So it's more than 7. How much more, we don't know. We infer from the mutants examined that successful functional conversion would, in this case, require 7 or more nucleotide substitutions. But evolutionary innovations requiring that many changes would be extraordinarily rare, becoming probable only on timescales much longer than the age of life on Earth. And they're talking about the age of life on Earth, not 6,000 years. Considering that KBL2 or BioF2 are judged to be close homologs by the usual similarity measures, this result and others like it challenge the conventional practice of inferring from similarity alone that transitions to new functions occurred by Darwinian evolution. Well, it looks like it could have. Well, have you done the numbers? And the answer is, when you do the numbers, that's not what you get. Okay, KBL2, this is my own comment for those of you who are interested. Oh, okay. Why did that do that? Oh. Okay, KBL2 catalyzes the reaction. Glycine plus acetyl-CoA yields 2-amino-3-ketobutyrate. And that's glycine. And you take the acetyl-CoA and you stick it onto here and you get something that looks like an amino acid, but has a ketone here. Now, if you were to change that ketone to an alcohol, you would have threonine. And that is, in fact, how you make how bacteria make threonine inside their cells. You see, the only difference between this and that is that this is a carbonyl group instead of an alcohol group. Now, BioF2 catalyzes the reaction in L-alanine plus pimolyl-CoA, which is basically a double-headed aliphatic dicarboxylic acid. And you put CoA on one end, and when you get done, you turn this. Now, you are nowhere near biotin. Biotin is this crazy molecule up here that has this part right there, but also has a sulfur, has one of the aminos is gone here. There's adding another amino and a carboxylic acid. This is actually substituted urea here. So it takes, I think, about 7 or 8 more steps before you can get to from this part to this part. But this is the part that kind of starts it off. And so here's an enzyme that does one thing, and now it's doing something entirely different. You notice that this is a long molecule here. Neither one of these are long molecules. Okay? And the thing that's interesting is the molecules look very similar. Now, these are actually dimers, so you'll notice that you have mirror images. You have the blue end is the amino end, and the red end is the carboxylic acid, I believe. Doesn't make too much difference. The important thing is you see you have a blue end here and you have a blue end here, and then they go and mix all up with each other, and then you have the red ends at the end. And you'll notice that this and this are very, very similar to each other. The structure is almost the same. A little bit of tweaking and that's it. And in fact, if you look at the two and you overlap them, you can see that there's fairly good overlap for most of it. And you can see that certain structures that are stuck to either doing pimolyl CoA or are stuck into doing acetyl CoA, and that some of the same structures are very similar to each other. So these have always been thought to be evolutionarily related because they're so close. And what else could do it besides design, and we don't want to talk about that. Specifically, using a population model described previously with the following assumptions, and I'm omitting the assumptions, and that's my omission, not theirs, we estimate that some 10 to the 30 or more generations would elapse before a bio-F-like innovation that is paralogous to KBL could be established. In the first paper, I'm switching over. This is my comment on that whole thing. In the first paper, Axe points out that it is not feasible to have more than 6 necessary mutations between one functional enzyme and another on an evolutionary pathway that is neutral, that aren't each one more advantageous than the other one. In the second paper, Gager and Axe point out that the pathway from one enzyme to another, and in particular the KBL, 2 to BioF2, another closely related one is at least 7 mutations, probably a little more. You're allowed 6, you need 7. And that's one of the closer related sets of enzymes. This precludes a simple pathway between the two enzymes. Now, you could have a complicated pathway where you go from KBL2 to another enzyme, to another enzyme, to another enzyme, and finally around to BioF2. But that takes longer. We don't even know if it even exists. And perhaps even more importantly, in the meantime, how are bacteria going to survive without biotin? You know, if you try to grow them on biotin-free media and they can't make their own biotin, they don't grow. What we have here, at least in my view, is anti-religion versus science. But that's my opinion. Now it's your turn. Yes, comment.
We obviously need more time on the evolutionary time scale.
Yeah, but more time means so much more time that we don't have it. That's the problem.
Now you see some articles.
Just a minute. We want to catch your comments. We've got it.
I think I've seen an occasional article now where they're talking about how this could be done quicker. So they're starting to talk about that point.
Yeah, they're starting to talk about it. You think about it. Lynch and Abegg were making a prediction that you can get any enzyme you want after a million mutational events, which should be able to be done on a platter in a year or so. It's interesting that when people tried this with E. coli, it didn't work that way. That you can get one, maybe two on the average. That's about it. Which is compatible with Douglas Sachs's computations.
Whereas not only do you have to get new ones, you have to keep the old ones around.
Well, yeah, but see, you could duplicate it. I mean, that's been around for a long time. See, basically, you know, it's like you copy it first. That's a mistake, but, you know, it's okay.
But that has to be guided, too, to keep their... That is still, you know, you need to guide it.
Yeah, and in the meantime, while you're trying to mutate this old enzyme into the new enzyme, the second copy, it's just as easy to mutate it anywhere else because the enzyme doesn't know. There's no advantage in what it's doing. The truth of the matter is that evolutionary biology, especially for larger organisms, but even to a certain extent for bacteria, will only require requires each stage to be advantageous. You know, one mutation and that gets selected for, and then the next mutation that gets selected for, and the next mutation that gets selected for, and then when you get, you know, 30 steps up. But if one of them is a step down, then it's tough for bacteria. And it's basically impossible for large animals like humans, elephants, giraffes, long-lasting, turtles.
Mickey just said a profound thought that I want to build on. What they're all looking for is to increase the mutation rate because the universe is way too young for a lot of these processes. I'd like to just address very briefly the fossil record because, as you know, you can take certain fossils that are supposed to be a certain molecular distance between today and similar organisms, you know, throughout the fossil record, and they hypothesize that it takes so many mutations to go from X to Y to Z. And
you're talking about like amphibians going to reptiles,
or even within a family.
Yeah,
it doesn't have to be across major phyla. And
it might be one terra branch to another terra branch or something
right.
Like that.
The whole thing is the fossil record is so impoverished. And it's just a matter of luck to find certain organisms. And that's why in China they're finding all kinds of new creatures. And they're starting, hopefully, to fill in some gaps if, from their standpoint, they need to fill in the gaps. Darwin's statement that he didn't want to use the fossil record because it didn't support evolution, and that's still true today. It's very hard to find these anchor points and work your way back. A thought I would like to make about finding anchor points is it's all a matter of extrapolation. We have a similar issue when it comes to the age of the universe and using astronomy. You know, you can measure shorter finite distances with binary stars, and you can work your way back, and you can look at one star rotating around another, and you can do all kinds of things. You can use the redshift, and you keep working your way back.
Yeah.
That is more of a science, a lot more of a science, than using the fossil record and working your way back. Fossil record is just terribly impoverished. So,
well, it's not only impoverished, but it also gives some very weird answers. Like, how much distance is there between horseshoe crabs now and horseshoe crabs 300 million years ago?
Yeah, exactly right. And that's the other point I was going to make, is that when you do have branching and you have new organisms supposedly coming through natural selection, you have to explain stasis too. And horseshoe crab is a prime example, but there's probably hundreds of examples of
Ginkgos,
extreme
calicans,
stasis. And so how do evolutionists explain the stasis in the evolutionary record versus the need for rapid, you know, supposedly major changes? I shouldn't say rapid, very slow changes, but major changes. I'd like to know, some of you may know, how do they harmonize the two ideas together? What do they do with stasis? We need a paper on that.
Exactly.
For posterity.
Well, the fossil, if it's this rich in diversity and going down all these multiple pathways all the time, even though fossils are just a small amount of what's preserved, right, of all living things, we should see a zillion examples of all these weird things rather than kind of well-defined functional examples. Was that,
yeah.
To me that seems like an obvious thought that I don't know. So how does that ever get addressed in evolutionary circles?
Well, actually it does when they discover a new fossil. You look at Ida. When it first came out in the papers, they said, "Oh, well, we haven't had a good fossil ancestor of humans." But now we have one. It's Ida. Well, wait a minute. What you're saying is that we didn't have a good example of fossil humans before, and then what happens if Ida collapses? Then we still don't have one, right? Which happened, by the way. And this is a problem of the mentality of never admitting that you have problems. And frankly, I think there's a reason for that. As I alluded to, Durrett and Schmidt, if you actually come out and fight intelligent design, creationism is a little bit different because the argument from radiometric dating, you can kind of sort of sustain it if you try. But in terms of intelligent design, if you come out and actually say what the truth is, it blows up in your face. Now, two examples, Durrett and Schmidt, who admitted that you can't get more than maybe one by luck, two-stage mutation between the ancestor of humans, and that's only 6 million years ago. If that's true, then the evolution of humans is basically impossible unless there is a direct, one-to-one, each mutation being advantageous pathway. And nobody has any clue of what that pathway might be, or even if it exists. The only way that you can say it exists is because you know it's got to exist, because you know that evolution happened, because you know that intelligent design is wrong, because otherwise you'd have to...
Now that's faith and not science.
Otherwise you'd have to believe in God and a few other things you don't want to believe in. And that's anti-religion versus science. The scientific evidence is overwhelmingly, frankly, in favor of design. But the only way to really argue is to keep it off the table. And Durrett and Schmidt made the mistake of taking Behe seriously. And once they did, the math just toasted evolutionary theory. Yes.
My point on reference to this discussion here, the average fossil species in the fossil record, according to geologic time, is there for about 1 million years, sometimes say 2 or 3 million years. But you follow those species, and generally you follow them for quite a ways through their geologic time scale. Now, of course, some people say, well, you know, if you're going to have a linear evolution, you evolve one organism for 1 million years, another species for another 1 million years, and so on, you know, you're going to have, you know,
600 million species just for
force. 600 species and so on. So they fall back on tunneling. Same system he talks here, you know. Have them evolving at the same time, all these different groups evolving sometime. But it takes an extremely fortuitous set of tunneling. For instance, most of your bird orders, modern bird orders, they arise within 12 million years. How are you going to have all those changes occurring in just 12 million years if one species lasts for 1 million years? And so they, Strehler, in his book, I think it's, I'm not sure it's that book. Anyway, states, one of these evolutionists clearly states, this is clearly preposterous to have, you know, how are you going to have a species with stasis for such a long time and that many species developing? And so they fall back on tunneling to a certain extent. But as I mentioned earlier, you know, your fossil record doesn't witness to tunneling. It's proposed all the time, all over the place. But you don't have the evidence of tunneling. You don't have all these species trying to change to each other and so on there. And the case for tunneling, of course, falls completely apart when you get to the Cambrian explosion, where people can talk about all these changes they want to among these closely related organisms. That's fine. Still, we don't find anything between these major basic phyla of the animal kingdom.
You don't have a half trilobite and a half anomalocarid, for example.
Exactly. So the fossil record, you know, it just does not permit the support. Well, they try and say, well, they all evolved together at the same time. We don't see the evidence of all those changes that they're talking about. Because you're going to have species to evolve all these things. I mean,
well, as a matter of fact, sometimes you have literal tunneling, such as the tunneling of the scapulae from the outside of the rib cage to the inside when you get to turtles.
Now wait just a minute. if I can tell you about a personal experience at the University of Michigan, I was called in by the professor of evolution and asked about my beliefs. And
this is where your PhD student and
yes. Folks, my whole career is on the line there. I told him, well, I can follow your reasoning to a certain extent, and I run into problems. He says, what are those problems? And I told him, you know, the turtle. First turtle you find is there. And it's so different. Why don't you find some intermediates below it and so on? And I talked about warm blood, and he told me after about 20 minutes, you're okay. Why did he say that? Two Seventh-day Adventists who had been there in that department before me, which I didn't know, were excused. And one of them, they say, turned into a preacher during his oral examinations for his comprehensive oral examination before he started his candidacy. And I was not a preacher, I was just talking to them in scientific terms. This is their language. This is the way to talk to them. Anyway, but the turtle is a good example. The bat's a good example. You don't find the intermediates for these things, and you can postulate all the tunneling you want to. Very hard to find good examples of tunneling in the fossil record. I mean, cases are extremely rare. I might add, you know, I thank God that I got through that situation there at the University of Michigan. It was a tense situation, and I see Warren from Michigan State University.
Michigan State, a rival of University of Michigan. I had a similar experience, but I won't take time to tell about it now. Where I was called into the red carpet with my major professor, my whole geology future could have been down the drain. But with the Lord's help, I did finish a degree, a master's in geology, paleontology. To keep up my reading, I'm a librarian, but to keep up my reading, I like to go to news sites that feature paleontology. So I do a Google search, and I did one this morning, paleontology in the news. You speak of turtles. They now have found in China a turtle that is brand new to science, and they claim it has rudimentary teeth. Because, as you know, turtles today, none of them have teeth, right? They don't have sockets, and they don't have teeth. They're kind of like birds, you know. But this one, I looked at the picture carefully, and there's little nubbins on the palate. Now, why would you find teeth scattered around the palate? They're really stretching the case by claiming that the original turtles had teeth. Well, why do they need it? They need it because turtles evolved from creatures that once had teeth. So you have to explain the loss of teeth and so on. That was a giant leap of faith. Someone mentioned it takes faith. That, to me, it was a giant leap of faith to claim that this creature had teeth.
The real problem with the turtle, at least I should say, is not a question of teeth. You see, in the turtle, you got such a basic difference in organization of your pectoral girdle. Now, you see, our pectoral girdles and those of all other vertebrates supports our arm, our anterior appendage, whichever terminology you want to use. That's on the outside of your rib cage. In the evolutionary scenario, the rib cage of some reptile changed into the shell. Okay.
And in fact, I think if you look on the inside, you can still see ribs coming across.
The vertebral column is tied to the top of the shell, and you have protrusions there and so on. Well, the problem is, how are you going to move a pectoral girdle, your scapula, your clavicle, and so on, that are on the outside of your ribs, onto the inside for the turtle, where it is? And the turtle, those bones, the names are similar, but they're in entirely different position. They're inside the ribs. To move a bone gradually by evolution from outside to the inside, you're going to have to do a lot of magic here, I think. Can you do it? Well, maybe you'll stick the ribs way out, the scapula way out here, and then finally put it inside. This is, how are you going to get it through the ribs there if you've got ribs in the way? This is essentially impossible. But you can move that bone all you want. You got to move the blood vessels. You got to move the muscles. You got to move the muscle attachments. Every bone has to have muscle attachments and so on. All this has to occur. Every step has to have survival value, and you don't leave any record in the fossil record. Now, I might make one point. There's one intermediate is being suggested possibly as, but it doesn't clearly have the scapula. It looks like the scapula is more on the outside of the ribs than inside. It's just an odd ball, but it's not a real turtle with the pectoral girdle on the inside of the rib cage. And it's not a very good specimen anyway. But don't get the idea that there aren't. They'll find something, you know, kind of intermediate. But the process of changing from one type to the other seems utterly impossible.
Oh, yeah.
In terms of having everything functioning all the way through a gradual process of evolution.
Well, speaking of the, you know, the best defense is to keep them at bay and not even let them get to talk. The other example that I can think of where somebody actually engaged the question is Eugene Koonin, who calculated how unlikely it was to get a self-replicating RNA, and then to get it would be RNA to protein at that time. It would later change to be DNA to protein, presumably. But to get from RNA to protein, and he says you can get RNA maybe with some really, really favorable assumptions once in the history of the universe. He says, but once you try to get to the protein machinery, it'll take 10 to the 1,000 universes, more or less. And that's out in print now. And see, that's why you don't touch it, because as soon as you do the calculations, you're toast. It's better, if you're an evolutionist, just to say, well, the odds can't be calculated, so don't even try. Because once you actually start doing the calculations, it is totally ridiculous. I got into a discussion once with P.C. Meyer before I knew who P.C. Meyer was on the internet. And I gave all kinds of, you know, only half that the bases need to be in order. We'll take the smallest organism we know, we'll cut it in half. We allowed for every sun to have a planet on it of Earth's size, and that to be continually churning out RNA. And the more, you know, which are totally ridiculous assumptions in terms of trying to get the origin of life. When we got done, the odds were still astronomically low. I mean, you know, in the 10 to the 200,000 range or something like that. It's just not going to happen. At first I got this blistering, well, you forgot about this, and 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 so I wrote back, well, actually, I didn't forget about this, and I didn't forget about this, and I didn't forget about this, and yes, I did assume this. Do you have a smaller number you would rather use? I went through the list, and when we got done, he said, would you like to go into a graduate program somewhere? So, you know, the facts of the matter are that, as in this study, these two studies which go together, you know, one the theoretical one and one the practical one, where it says that even in closely related enzymes, you can't get from enzyme A to enzyme B. It's just too many changes. That evolution is not practical. The reason it's being believed is because it fulfills the need to have a naturalistic theory that doesn't have any interference from anybody outside, which means it doesn't need any interference from God. That's bottom line.
Evolution relies very heavily on time.
It relies on the alternative being unacceptable.
Yes, but in this time situation, don't you calculate it out? If you calculate it out, you're going to render all kinds of problems all the time.
Exactly.
It's just, well, a lot of time. As long as we have time, time will perform miracles if you give it enough time.
And, as a, and don't ask how much is enough.
But don't calculate it out. And a lot of geological processes fall in the same category. We have, our changes are going much too fast right now to fit with the geological time scale. And they say, well, we're in an extremely rapid period, it was slower before. This is not, this is speculation, of course. When you use the present to straight the past, you run into very serious problems. Talking about rates of erosion, of course, and paraconformities and all this issues where calculate it out. And we ran into one the other day here, you remember, where talking about rates of scarp retreat. We were talking about scarp retreat, and I calculated out the rate of horizontal scarp retreat, as you'd have in Monument Valley, for instance, but they have a good figure on the Grand Staircase.
Right.
Has to be 100 times faster than vertical, average vertical retreat downward, which has the help of gravity. How are you going? The only way you're going to do this horizontal washing out of the Grand Staircase is to have a lot of water, doing it all rapidly at once.
Yeah, but when you're talking about a lot of water, we're talking, you know...
Yeah, a lot of water.
We're talking an eighth of an Earth-sized water going through.
We're talking about the worldwide flood. The receding waters of the worldwide flood would do this.
So, refresh my number on my memory on the numbers now. So, 14.5 billion years, age of the universe, 4.5 for solar system.
Yeah, 13 point something for the age of the universe. It's varied from 8 to 20, depending on which year you're talking about, but 13 is the accepted.
And then 4.5 for the solar system?
4.5 for the solar system, 4.6, something like that, yeah.
Any kind of life then?
Any kind of life that varies. Well, they'd really like to not have it quite so fast because now it's starting to push for, which means that the Earth really didn't have time to, I mean, life occurred right after the Earth cooled enough to allow it. Which
with
means that
bacteria,
the origin of life must have been incredibly fast.
So what? What was original?
Well,
fungus
for a while it was 600 million, and then it was 2 billion, 3 billion, and then 3.4 billion, and then 3.8 billion.
You're talking about what?
The origin of life?
Man, you only have a few hundred thousand years in there. You got to cool your Earth down, and you got fossils at 3.8 billion.
Yeah.
So
to 4.6.
So fossils at about 4 billion.
Well, that's
what?
The standard. That's the standard dating.
Yeah, you'd have to evolve life in less than a billion years. In a billion years, yes, a few hundred thousand. Takes a lot of faith to believe in that.
But
again, don't try to calculate this stuff because if you do, the numbers are kind of come out.
Then multicellular life then would be. What's the working?
Well, actually, cyanobacteria are single cell. I mean, are protists, if I remember correctly. But the algae, at least, are eukaryotic, right?
Yes.
How far back do they go?
Almost 2 billion.
Yeah.
Right, so
but you've got suggestions of 3.5, 3.8 billion years for the first life.
Okay.
That has to be an organism that can reproduce itself.
Well, as a matter of fact, people like Francis Crick, you know, who's a nut job, obviously. I mean, only got the Nobel Prize for discovering DNA. Are proposing that the stuff came from outer space and landed on the Earth. Why? Because there isn't enough time to originate life. And they think, well, once we get to evolution, we're okay, because then you can have one organism that stays alive until finally it gets enough changes to become another organism. But see, as you can see from this data here, evolution itself isn't really viable given the time constraints.
Plus,
well, even if it came from elsewhere, you still only have 14 billion years, right?
So, that's right.
Or less. I mean, you really have to cool down and get something first.
And presumably on wherever the star was.
And
it's probably not
elements.
In a different galaxy, just because it takes too long to get between galaxies.
Well, you need several generations of stars to get all the elements, too. So there's that issue.
Yeah, but you're asking too many questions. There's a comment back here.
We've discussed what is the cause of, or evolution to keep God, no God. What is the cause of theistic evolution?
Well, theistic evolution is so that you don't have to dispute the evolutionists who have it all wrapped up. And everybody knows that, and anybody who doesn't know that is one of those crazy creationists there. Even if they're an intelligent design believer, they're a crazy creationist. Even if they're an intelligent design believer like Michael Behe, who believes in common ancestry and billions of years and all that stuff, he's a creationist. Why is he a creationist? Because anything that postulates that something outside of science interpreted as pure naturalism had to be around is just not acceptable. Because once you postulate some kind of being outside of that, it becomes very obvious very rapidly that whatever that something is, it's got to be technologically more advanced than we are. Because we, looking at its models, can barely recreate parts of some of them. And whatever this thing is, if there was a designer, it was a designer that had, if I can put it that way, godlike powers. And furthermore, if this designer also created the universe, because that's another problem for science, then he had godlike macro powers as well. And at this point, it's really difficult to understand why we wouldn't call this power God.
So,
they don't. Yeah, maybe he's tried to communicate with us. Maybe we should be listening to him.
So the theistic people don't want to be labeled crazies, basically.
That's right. The theistic evolutionists don't want to be labeled crazy by today's sciences. So they are actually hostile. It's interesting. You would think that the divide would go between theists and non-theists. You really would. But the divide actually runs between theistic evolutionists in the more modern sense. The ancient sense would have been happy. Behe is an ancient theistic evolutionist. He believes in change, just that God helped it along here a little bit there, here and there. I kind of wonder about some of these people. I wonder whether they kind of secretly wouldn't mind if the whole thing were to collapse and they could believe in a quasi-biblical story. I know that's the case for Philip Johnson. His head is with the long ages, but his heart is with the short age people. You can tell by just listening to him. And I think that if people were freed from the pressure of having to bow to an atheistic, totally naturalistic project, we might be surprised at how many people turn out to find creationism quite attractive. I am told that happened in Russia once the communist government fell, and and could not enforce atheism anymore, that you had people coming out of the woodwork saying, we don't believe in evolution anyway. That was one of those communist plot things, you know, and we don't need that. What do you have to say? And they were quite open to people arguing for a creationist, a full-blooded creationist proposal. We, I think, are going to be very, very surprised at what happens in the near future. Mostly in a good way. Some in a bad way, but you know, you take the bad with the good.
That's kind of our eschatology. It's not going to be between people who believe in God versus those that don't. It's going to be between those that are religious that want to do away with, you know, say that you're being not religious enough as far as, you know, keeping Sunday and so forth. So that's, it's not a discussion between believers and non-believers. It's an issue between those that say they believe.
Yeah, it's a question of what kind of God do you believe in.
I think the issue of time is going to come into the picture.
Well, I think so too.
Say again?
The issue of time will come into the picture.
Was it a recent creation, or was it progressive creation over billions of years?
Yeah.
Era.
Anyway, come back next week, and we will have some more fun with another paper.
Yeah.
And then I think after that will be Sean Pittman, and then the movie, which I think is stunning.